There is a myth that chess grandmasters can see up 10, 15, or even 20 moves ahead. This is actually not true, but there are methods to forecast what will happen after a certain move. The same applies to an Interact project. In the application form, projects are asked to forecast how and why a desired change is expected to happen from their activities. This is also called the intervention logic.
Yes, and the term intervention logic is a typical Interact vocabulary. Intervention logic sounds like something very complicated, but it is not. It simply reflects the different steps a project will make to achieve a desired outcome, to make a positive impact in the North Sea region, ultimately.
Thank you, Jenny, and welcome everyone to this webinar. My name is Annemieke Vijkens. I'm a project advisor at the Interact North Sea Joint Secretariat. And I'm here today with Jenny Thompson, also project advisor. And behind the scenes, my colleague Femke Boersma is also helping us out with the technicalities of this webinar. The start of a new program period also brings changes to the intervention logic and the indicators that projects will use. You can see on the screen now the full intervention logic that will be used during the new program period. But please don't get afraid by all these different building blocks. We will go through them during this webinar step by step.
Yes, this is what we will do, Annemieke, and it may be easier than you now think. And my first recommendation for those of you that have experience with the current program is to please forget everything you know about intervention logic terms and indicators. As we have harmonized with other programs, the building blocks and their names are different in the next program period. So please don't let these differences confuse you. We hope that with today's webinar, we can explain the concept in an accessible way and help you applying the intervention logic to your project idea correctly. Can you please explain, Annemieke, why the topic of today's webinar is so important?
Yes, I think indeed it is very important because the intervention logic and the indicators can help you to structure the project and set realistic objectives. But it will also help the program to understand your path towards achieving your objectives and to monitor this path during project implementation. It is a key part of your application form, and a solid intervention logic will increase your chances of approval.
Yes, and I would like to underline that and maybe add that the topic intervention logic and indicators is really key for your application form. Your project application form stands and falls with the intervention logic.
Yes, that is right. And therefore, we have set the following objective for this session. We hope that at the end of this session, you will be able to accurately apply the program's new intervention logic and indicator system to your project idea. Do you think we can achieve this, Jenny?
Well, I have very good hopes, Annemieke. But in order to get there, we have prepared an agenda for you. We will start out with explaining the different building blocks of the intervention logic. Then we will have a closer look at the indicators, which will form part of the intervention logic. And lastly, we will have sufficient time to answer your questions. In case we can't answer all of your questions time-wise, we will make sure to answer them on our website afterwards. But before we get started, please note that this webinar is recorded, as Annemieke has already mentioned. The recording will be published on our website together with this PowerPoint presentation. But if you don't want to be recorded, please switch off your camera and or rename yourself. On another note, the chat is closed during this webinar. But other positive news, we will use Slido instead during the session and for the question and answer part. The only thing you have to do is go to slido.com. And I would suggest that you do that on your mobile phone, actually. When you are there, you enter the code North Sea, and then that should be it. You should be able to see one column for questions and one column for polls. And you can switch basically between them And if you have questions along the way throughout our intervention, please feel free to put in your questions. But as you can see, some of you maybe who have managed to log into Slido, there is already a poll ongoing because we would like to test if you have all managed. And we have the following question for you prepared. When I think about the words intervention logic, the first thing that comes to my mind is, and now it's up to you to fill this little gap here with whatever pops up in your mind when you hear the word intervention logic. And we are very curious to see what you have to say.
I see there are also already some responses. Someone says, what? Question mark.
Yeah, very good one.
I can very well understand that you're thinking that right now. Sounds complicated. Yes, structure. Some people actually like structure.
And we have also someone who says, no idea. So that's really good. So we also have newcomers here today, as far as I understand. No idea. Even more of them. That's good to see. And that's the reason why you are here today, to learn more about it.
Europe, and that's also interesting because I think this is actually, this term is only used within European projects, so that could be the reason why it's there. What impact? Explain the difference. Good to see that so many of you are active in Slido. And since
impact,
what and no idea are very big, I think we should get started with the different building blocks. We will start with the different building blocks that together form the intervention logic. But before we can get into the specifics of a project, we will take a look at the framework the program is providing, as these also part of the building blocks. And as you can see on the screen, and you may have seen this image before already in the previous webinars, the program content is divided into four priorities. Priority one mainly focuses on innovation and skills. Priority two mainly focuses on climate mitigation. Priority three on climate adaptation. And while those three priorities may remind you of the current content of the current program, priority four has an entirely new approach and focuses on improving transnational governance in the region. And as you can see, each priority also lists a series of specific objectives. Could you tell us a little bit more about that, Jenny?
Definitely. So each project has to choose a priority, as you've explained, and one of the connected priority specific objectives. There are two priority specific objectives for priority one, five for priority two for priority three, and one for priority four. The priority specific objectives you choose is key because it demonstrates the link between the program objective and your project objective. And it also defines which indicators you can choose, but we will get to that later during our intervention. First, back to you, Annemieke.
Yes, and there's actually one part of this graph we haven't covered yet, which are the spotlight themes. And the spotlight themes are actually not part of the intervention logic. Projects are asked to identify the spotlight themes a project covers because the program wishes to know to what extent these themes are covered in the program. You can find more information about all these priority specific objectives and spotlight themes on our website. The draft content of the program has recently been published, so I would definitely recommend you to take a look at that before you get started with your intervention logic. When we go to the next slide, which shows the different building blocks of the intervention logic, you can see we have actually already covered two building blocks, namely the two program building blocks of the intervention logic. So now we can get started with the project parts of the intervention logic. How do we get started with this, Jenny?
Well, we start with the most important part of the intervention logic, and that is the project overall objective. As the word already says, This building block describes the overall objective of your project. This is normally what you should start with when thinking about your intervention logic. And your project's overall objective must have a clear link with a program level, so the two boxes above. In addition, the overall objective is the starting point for all other parts of your project intervention logic that will follow in our presentation. But before we move on, I think it's time for another question. Since the Since the project overall objective is the first thing you should think about, I'm very curious to see or to hear whether you out there already have some ideas of your project overall objective. So please go to Slido again. And the question is the following. Have you already thought about your project overall objective? For answer possibilities, I have some ideas, but they are still under construction. My project overall objective is crystal clear, or no, I don't know yet. And I can see that you are already very active in answering this.
I can see most people already have some ideas. I can't see the percentages on the screen, but it seems to be the biggest group. So most people have some ideas so far. I can see it, 41%. But they're still under construction. Some people don't have any idea yet.
But that's good. If you have some ideas, but it's still under construction, we hope then with this webinar to provide you with more input even to then get everything together and move forward with your idea.
And it might be when you read more about the program content that you get actually inspired by the example actions, for example, in the program.
And we can also see that we have someone or some participants actually that have a project overall objective that is crystal clear already. That sounds really promising.
Yes, it does. Let's go back to our slideshow, because when you know your project overall objective, it is actually time to start thinking about the next step, which are the work package objectives. And the work package objective reflects the smaller steps towards reaching your project overall objective. In other words, the accumulated effect of the achievement of the work package objectives should be the achievement of your project overall objective. And with the work package objectives, we actually come closer to the work packages and the actual activities of your project. What does that look like, Jenny?
Yes, as you can see on the slide, each work package objective is connected to a range of activities in the respective work package. For each activity in a work package, and now listen carefully, you will have to select a deliverable from a list and set a target for this deliverable. But don't worry, we have prepared a list of deliverables for you on the slide, and you can choose from this list.
Jenny, what I don't understand that if you already have the activities in your application form, why then do you also need deliverables?
That's a very good question, Annemieke. There is actually a simple answer to this. By selecting a deliverable, you make sure that the implementation of the activities is measurable. The deliverables can be seen as quantifiers of the activities. And an example would be if part of a project is about organizing a series of workshops for SMEs, the selected deliverable would be chosen from the list, external event. And the target is then the number of workshops you're planning to organize. So for example, 5. So it's quite simple actually.
Yes, thank you for clarifying that, Jenny. And after the activities, we actually come across an entirely different type of building blocks, namely the indicators. And after you and during your implementing the activities, you of course want to measure the project success and the positive effects on the North Sea region. And to do this, the program uses indicators. All indicators are predefined by the program. You only have to just provide descriptions and targets for the indicators. As you can see here on the screen, the first type of indicators we come across are the output indicators. Output indicators should be a direct outcome of the activities. And as you can see on the screen, the outputs are selected on work package level. Since the outputs are predefined, as we already mentioned, we can actually provide you with a list with output indicators you can choose from, which you can now see on the screen. The output indicators you can choose from are pilot actions developed jointly and implemented, strategies and action plans jointly developed, and project partners. We will tell you more about these indicators later, after you have also addressed the result indicators. Jenny?
Yes, the results indicators. They are not selected on work package level, but on project level, as you can see on the slide. They reflect the wider uptake of the project outputs. And I would like to highlight one more time here that result indicators are, like output indicators, predefined. So contrary to the current program, it is not possible to define your own indicators. We have also a list of result indicators prepared for you that you can choose from, and you can choose one or more of in total 3 result indicators. The result indicators measure the uptake of new solutions, the uptake of strategies and action plans, and last but not least, increased capacity in internal and external organizations. Also, the result indicators should have a direct link to the activities of the work packages, but this is the case with all parts of the intervention logic. So each building block has a connection to other parts of the intervention logic, so to other building blocks. So it should all be connected with each other. And also here, the uptake of new solutions or strategies and action plans include, for example, dissemination activities that have to be described on work package level. I hope that's clear.
I think it is, Jenny. And now that we have seen all building blocks, it's time to tell you a little bit more about these indicators. And you can now see all of them on the screen because there are clear links between the output and the results indicators. And I would also like to repeat what Jenny just said. You have to choose from this list. And this is an important difference compared to the current program, because some of you that are joining this webinar may already have a project in the current program, which means you had to define your own result indicators. And this will not be the case in the new program. You might now think, what if I, for example, decrease CO2 emissions in my project in the new program? Where should I fill that in the application form? That's why we have prepared another Slido question for you. And the question reads, if my project reduces CO2 emissions, where do I put that in the application? A, in the results, B, somewhere else in the application, or C, nowhere in the application. So please go to Slido again and answer the question for us.
And we can see that someone has answered already. And the opinion here is in the results.
Results.
Let's wait and see if there are other answers. Somewhere else in the application form is growing. That has stopped.
Yes, let's see if more and more people want to answer this question. It's interesting to see that a lot of people would still fill it in the results section.
It is a difficult question, I have to say.
It is tricky, yeah.
But we are mentioning this in order to help you. So let's see what Annemieke has to say about the
Do you think it's time?
Yeah, I think
the right
so.
Answer?
Yes. Yeah, I think so.
I see actually now the people that giving the right answer is the number of people is growing, because mm-hmm. the correct answer is somewhere else in the application, answer B. And as CO2 reduction is not covered by one of the result indicators in the predefined list, you cannot fill it in there in the application form. However, the program is of course still interested to know about these types of outcomes of your project. And we would therefore strongly recommend to fill it in somewhere else in your application form.
Yes, thanks for making that very clear, Annemieke. Let's now dive a bit more into details. When we look at the first set of indicators in the first row of the table, you can see that the output shows the number of pilots. Thus, you have to define the number of pilots in each work package. Afterwards, when you get to the results, you measure how many solutions have been taken up as a result of the project activities. How does it work in the second set, Annemieke?
Yeah, the same more or less applies to the second set. So the output indicators measures the number of strategies and action plans that are jointly developed in the project, while the result indicator measures the joint strategies and action plans that are taken up by organizations. There's a clear link between those indicators, as you can see as well.
Yeah, sounds good. And then we move on to the last kind of set of indicators, which is a bit more special. Because you don't have to do anything to measure the output indicator. So this is really easy. Now you might ask yourself why? And the answer is because this indicator, project partners, will be automatically filled in by the online monitoring system because it counts the number of project partners in the project. So lucky you, I would say. However, the connected results indicator, which is called organizations with increased institutional capacity due to their participation in cooperation activities across borders, basically measures increased capacity both in project partner organizations as well as in external organizations. This should be measured with a special form that has to be filled in by each organization that measures increased capacity. You will find the form in the fact sheet on intervention logic and indicators. And as some of you might know or have heard already, the fact sheets are currently in progress. They will be tabled at our program preparation group meeting mid-November. And as soon as they are approved, you will be able to find them on our website. Now I have another little trick question for you. So please go to Slido again. And when we have now looked at these indicator sets, and the question is, what do you think the targets for the output and results indicators will look like? We have four answer possibilities. I will read them out loud. So the first option is that the targets for the output indicators are always the same as the targets of the results indicators, or the output targets are always higher than the result targets, or the output targets are always lower than the result targets. And the last option is that none of the above is correct. And now I think we can switch to Slido and see your answers. I hope we don't confuse you with this question. Annemieke will explain the correct answer, but let's see what your understanding is at the moment. And I can see that none of the above has received so far the most answers.
Yes, a large part of you actually think that none of the above is true. Then some people also think that the targets for the outputs are always lower than the targets of the result indicators. But it's a lot lower than the people that say none of the above. And I think I will give the right answer now. And
yes, go for it.
I want to say congratulations. Most of you were right. The correct answer is none of the above. And I'll just explain that with the first set of indicators, which is the number of pilots implemented and the solutions taken up as the result. And it could, for example, be that you have some pilots in the project that are not successful and do not lead to a solution taken up. In this case, the targets will not be the same because the target for the output indicator, the number of pilots implemented, will be higher than the number of solutions taken up, which is the result indicator. In other cases, all pilots lead to a solution, which means that the targets will be the same for the output and the result indicator. So there's not always, it's not always the case that the number is the same or higher or lower. It could vary in different projects. And when you know what exactly counts towards one of the indicators, I would like to repeat Jenny's recommendation to take a look at the fact sheet as soon as they're published, because they will also contain the exact definitions of all of the indicators.
Thanks for clarifying this, Annemieke. And there is still one more thing that we have to cover before we go to the question and answer part of this webinar. Those of you that have listened carefully already heard that you can select, for example, 1, 2, or 3 result indicators. And as you can already see on the slide, this is not always the case. While most projects can indeed select all indicators that were just presented, this does not apply to priority 4 projects, which will be governance projects. As Annemieke has highlighted in the beginning, this is a new priority in the program, and priority 4 projects cannot select the first set of indicators purely because of the nature of priority 4. It is not expected that those projects will implement many pilots, and it is for sure the case that the focus of governance projects will not be on pilots. So that's why.
And I Thank you, Jenny. Definitely. Yes, and I know we have been talking for quite a while now, and also see on the clock that there are still quite some time left. So let's open the floor for questions. And if you have not done so yet, please open Slido. You can do that by going to slido.com and entering the code NordC. And we will try to answer all of your questions, but in case this will not be possible due to the time constraints, we will answer the questions that are left on our website. So let's shift to Slido to see if there are already some questions in there.
Yeah, maybe just to add, Annemieke, there might also be questions, like follow-up questions to the polls we have had. I mean, that can also be the case. So feel free to put in whichever question you have, and then we will try to answer these questions.
Yes. I see there is already a question in there. What is the difference between spotlight teams and specific objectives? Maybe I'm asking too early.
I don't know when you have posted this this question, but I think it was explained already by Annemieke to a certain extent. So we have the priorities and then the specific priority-specific objectives. They are very important, and you have to choose them to then form your intervention logic further. With the spotlight themes, this is a different case. The spotlight themes have been identified as very important topics of the future program. They go across priorities, across specific objectives. And in the application form, you will be asked if you contribute to one or more of the spotlight themes, and if so, how you are contributing to those. So this is it in a nutshell, I would say. Do you have anything to add, Annemieke?
Yeah, I agree very much with your answer. And maybe when we consider it in the context of the other building blocks, the spotlight themes are not part of the logical flow. So your project overall objective doesn't necessarily have to connect to one of the spotlight themes. They have to connect to a specific objective. And I would consider the spotlight themes more as an add-on to your project. So we can see which of these themes your project is also targeting. Are there any other questions?
Very good question. Can I have an activity without a deliverable? Do you want to go, Annemieke?
Yes, and the answer to this question, I think, is quite simple. This is not possible because for each activity in the application form, you will have to select one of the deliverable indicators. And I know there might be cases where one of the standard deliverable indicators might not entirely fit your activity, but luckily there is a category other where you can define your own deliverable. Yeah. I hope you agree with this, Jenny.
Yes, I do agree. So as Annemieke has pointed out, there is one category that's called other. We, of course, encourage all of you to choose not the other category, but in total we have six, so the other five, because that makes it more explicit what exactly you are working with. And only in cases where you can't find a fitting deliverable, then please choose the category other. And just to highlight one more time, maybe, that the deliverables, they are not part of this official indicator thing, but they actually measure the activities you're doing. And yeah, the example I had was hopefully quite easy with the external events and the webinars or events you are organizing, that you organize as an activity, some webinars, let's say, or workshops, and then you have to count them as external events, for example, five. That was the example I had. So it's basically a matter of measuring the activities you're planning.
Yes, I hope this was clear. If not, please post another question in the Q&A. And I see there is another question now on the screen. Do you expect a minimum and maximum number of work packages? Now, minimum, I would say at least one, but maybe it's good to say here that the work practice will also look a little bit different from what they do, because we currently have in the program one standard work package for project management and one standard work package for communication. And this will not be the case in the next program period. So these two work packages will not exist basically in your next program, but they will be integrated in other parts of the application form. So this leaves us only with the content work packages. And it depends a bit also on the number, on the type of project you're applying for, because we also will have small scale projects where you can only have one work package. And I think for a normal project or a regular project, we generally expect about three work packages. Yes. That's what we usually see in project as well.
And I don't have anything to add. We can move on. what is the focus definition of increased capacity in the third result? And I was so clever to bring my papers with me, and maybe I can just quickly read out for you the one short part of the definition so that we are really all on the same page. And it says here, the indicator counts the number of organizations that increased their institutional capacity in a thematic field of a project by actively participating in cooperation activities across borders. And this means that it is not supposed to be only one, let's talk about an external organization now, it's not supposed to be only one contact that this external organization has with the project and the project activities, but it's more a constant contact and involvement, and also in an active role. So it's not only participating in a webinar or something, it's really cooperating in an active way. And then we have talked about this form that needs to be filled out either by internal organizations or external organizations. And there are different fields defined in which capacity has been increased. So this is this would be my answer. Do you have something to add, Annemieke?
I think that was very clear, at least to me. So nothing to add from my end. But if something is not clear, please put that in the Slido again. So let's see if there are more questions. Oh, there's someone confused about our CO2 example.
Very good that you're mentioning it here.
Yes, thank you. And the question is, if a solution leads to a CO2 reduction, isn't that part of the results? Is it just about counting the number of solutions? Yes, that is right. So we have this indicator pair, which is about where the output is pilots and the result indicator is solutions taken up. And this really only counts the number of solutions taken up. So nothing else, not CO2 reduction. If you also reduce CO2 as a result of your project, this cannot be measured by the official indicators. But again, it would still be very interesting to know about this from the program's perspective. So please enter it somewhere else in the form, in the application form.
Yeah.
So I hope this kind of took your confusion away, but
maybe I can just one more time say that we really have to stick to these predefined output indicators and results indicators. Everything on top of that, for example, CO2 reduction that we will achieve, we are very much encouraging you to put that somewhere else in the application form, because it's very, very relevant and it's very, very needed. However, it can unfortunately not be captured as part of this specific tab, which is called results indicators.
Yeah,
I really hope it's clear, otherwise put it in again.
Yeah, and maybe I can still elaborate a little bit on that, because maybe it's also interesting to know why we now have these predefined result indicators. And this is also, this is because we are harmonizing with other programs, because in the current program, not all programs were having project-defined result indicators. And this might be confusing if you have a project in different programs. So now in all Interreg programs, there will be predefined output and result indicators. And some of the programs will actually use the exact same indicators as we do.
Just to add, some other programs might use other indicators, but they are also kind of predefined. So no matter where you apply, you have to choose from a predefined list of output indicators and results indicators. And in our program, it was concluded that we will work with the ones that we have presented today.
Yeah. I see there's another question. I think you said that dissemination must be included on work package level. Is it also possible to include a project level dissemination plan? The dissemination.
I'm not entirely sure I understand the question correctly, but I'm not sure what the person is referring to, but Annemieke has mentioned at some point that we have in the current program always a work package on project management and communication. And those two work packages will no longer exist as work package. They will have to be included in other parts of the application form. There are dedicated questions for that. So you will be asked about it, but it will not be part of the work package. And if you describe which kind of communication efforts you will do, you can, of course, include parts that tackle project level dissemination plan. So, but not as part of the work package. Let me put it differently, not as part of a specific work package, but you can include communication efforts and everything also as part of activities in the different work packages.
I think the underlying idea is that communication is always connected to the content of the project. So therefore, communication activities are included in the content work packages, and also dissemination activities, and also, and for example, writing a dissemination plan could be included in one of the other, the content work packages, which are the only work packages you will have.
Yeah. So that's what we mean with elsewhere in the application form, elsewhere outside the work packages or as part of activities and deliverables in the different content work packages. Yes. Interreg projects often prepare for upscaling and rollout. Real results will happen after the projects. How do we work with this?
Yes, this is a tricky question, because after the project is closed, we can't, of course, entirely monitor what happens afterwards. So what is included in the application form as part of the indicators is only what you can measure during project implementation before the end date of the project. If you expect any other large results that will only happen after the project, this is of course still very valuable information. It's not measured by the indicators, we can't monitor it, but it would still be very interesting to have this information in the application form. So yeah, please do include it. But yeah, as I said, it's not an indicator. It's impossible to monitor through reporting throughout the project. So yeah, it's not part of the targets of your indicators.
Yeah, nothing to add from mine.
Go ahead, Jenny.
Will small scale projects have the same indicator set? And yes, that is true. All the different applications we will have in the NOSI region program will have to apply the same set of indicators. So that is the rule for small scale projects. Then we also have expressions of interest and the full applications. And in each application form, you will be asked to provide output indicators and results indicators, as well as the fact that you should have thought carefully through this whole intervention logic before you apply.
That's entirely right. Nothing to add. Are the overall targets for the indicators on program level? I wonder if this person means with on program level, if that's has overall targets on program level. I'm not sure if I understand the question actually.
No. So maybe there's one thing we can say here, and that is that all the projects out there will achieve certain output indicator, like a certain number of outputs and results indicators, and that will all be
accumulated
and then be measured, so that the whole program will be measured on that. We have to find
And of course we also have targets on program level,
exactly,
which we hope that projects will achieve. But that's not necessarily relevant for your project. You should just be realistic about your targets on project level.
Yeah, exactly. But you basically contribute to the program level. I think that's the main message. If we haven't answered the question correctly, then or if you're still in doubt, just put another question in. And then we have another question. Are there objective specific differences for indicators? I'm also not sure I understand the question correctly, but I think the question is if indicators are different from priority specific objective to priority specific objective. And the answer is no, except for the fact that we have highlighted that the first set of indicators about pilots and solutions taken up cannot be applied for priority four projects, so the specific priority specific objective 4.1.
Yes, I hope that that was indeed the question. Please let us know if you had a different question. Would the CO2 reduction perhaps be in the overall project aim? We usually see project overall objectives that are a bit broader than just CO2 reductions, and it also has a link with the specific field you're applying in. So I would say it's not the overall aim, although it could be very close to the overall aim, especially when you look at, for example, projects in priority two.
But it could be.
It's usually a bit more specific than just the CO2 reduction. Do you agree with that, Jenny?
Yes, it could, however, be mentioned as part of it, right? That it will then lead to. But you're completely right in saying that the overall project objective is a bit broader than a specific CO2 reduction. But yes.
Yeah.
And I think maybe at this point, we should also say that If you have these questions and you are always, of course, developing your project idea further and further, and maybe you're also thinking about getting feedback from the secretariat, talking to the national contact points, we can also help you when we see where you are with your project idea and you start filling out the application form, then you might find this, a place for this. And if not, just ask us and say, yeah, but we also have CO2 reduction in mind. Where do we put it here in our concrete example? So I think it's quite specific and yep. Depends from project to project. It's individual.
Yeah, and just when you have no idea what the application form looks like, we will have quite a lot of open text fields in the beginning of the application where you, for example, explain the added value of your project. And I think this could be a good place to also include, for example, CO2 reduction that you expect to happen from the project.
Yeah. And then we have the question, do results need to be achieved by the end of the project? And my answer is here, yes, that is the idea behind it. And this is what you should aiming for.
Yeah. Yeah, that is right. And therefore, it is, I think, important to already think at project application stages, not only think what will be the target and what will be the end result of the project, but also will I be able to measure this during the implementation of the project and before I submit my final report. So yeah, they need to be achieved by the end of the project and measurable. Yeah. Are those indicators predefined by the regulations? They to some extent are. As a program, we can choose from a list of indicators. So we have chosen from a list. Indirectly they are predefined by the regulations.
Yeah, exactly. And maybe one more word on the last results indicator that we have presented, the capacity building indicator. That was actually a wish. So we had this list of indicators, as Annemieke has described, but there was no indicator that was really measuring this. And the indicator capacity building was then developed by several programs together, taken up by the commission, so that this was also an indicator that we can choose. And several transnational programs are now using this capacity building indicator, and we as the North Sea region are one of them. So you will stumble over this indicator also in other programs.
Yep, that is right. Next question, could there be more than two levels of objectives in a project, like an intermediate level between the overall project objective and individual work packages?
This is making it even more complicated.
So this question suggests to add one more building block to the overall structure, I think.
I think
officially the answer would be no, but if this to some extent helps you to explain what your project is doing, I think you can again enter that somewhere else in the application form, but there will be only one field where you can enter your overall objectives, and there will be fields for the work package objectives and nothing in between, so to say. So I think the answer should be no.
Yeah, and maybe to highlight one more time, I don't know if the question goes into that direction, but also with I don't know what you mean by objectives, but if you're now talking about the priority specific objectives that are connected to the priorities, then you have to choose one. So you cannot choose two of these priority specific objectives. You really have to choose one in the application form and then develop your idea further around this kind of, or make your idea fit to one priority specific objective, just to make that clear. And your, as Annemieke mentioned, your own project objective, of course, if it helps you to structure it, but it's easier to, in the background maybe, but in the official application form, it's easier to stick to the official setup. That would be my suggestion.
Yeah, and I think when talking about the priority specific objective, I think there will definitely be crossovers. While you have chosen one priority specific objective, it could be that a side effect of your project also contributes to another priority specific objective. And I don't think it is even possible to develop a project that only contributes to one priority specific objective. But you will have to choose one, and that is the one that is has the most direct link, I would say, to your project overall objective.
Very good point. Very good point. Yeah. Do we have more? Yes. Will a project with a spotlight theme have a better chance of approval? That's a good question. And I think the clear answer here is no. But the program and the member states are interested in each and every project's contribution to these spotlight themes. So really take them into account, really think about if you contribute and how you contribute, and add that to the application form, even though it will not provide you with better chances to get approved.
Yeah, I fully agree. So it will not necessarily increase your chances, but the program is interesting in monitoring how many projects contribute to these themes, and also maybe to see if there are links between projects that are not necessarily applying in the same priority specific objective, but both have a spotlight theme. So it could be a way of also to group projects in a different way. Yeah.
Should we move on and see if there are more? Yes, there are. Is there a list of projects who are still looking for project partners? How can we find project partners from other countries? So there are different answers, I would say. So one answer is that you can always contact the national contact points that we have, I think, also present here today. I've seen Albin from the Netherlands is here today. You can find the contact details of the national contact points also on our website. And they are always very helpful, and they know best which organizations they have in their own country. So in case you need a specific organizations from a specific country, please reach out to the national contact points. That's one thing. Then there is another thing, that is our website. We are currently working on something to facilitate people coming together around certain project ideas and partner search, something along those lines. I don't think I can say much more about it because we are in the progress of it. I don't know when we will be done, but we are working on something like this. So stay tuned. That would be my answer here.
And I think there is one other option maybe you can go for, which is simply joining events like the Nordsee Conference, which will also provide you with many opportunities to network and to find people that work in similar fields. So that could also be an option if you're looking for partners.
Yes, and then there is another one. Did I understand correctly? So someone is asking again, that's very good, correctly, that usually there are only up to 3 work packages in a project. And that is correct, absolutely. So the recommendation is to have 3 work packages. Of course, there might be other projects where it's really needed to have a 4th one. Then, of course, if it fits into the project application, then it's fine. But in general, the recommendation is 3 work packages per project.
Yeah, and we can see in current projects that works well generally to not have too many work packages built. So, like 3 is a good number, I think, in general. And there is another question coming in: differences between first line of outputs and results, as the pilot actions and the solutions, and the second line strategies and actions are small. They sound similar. Yes. I think they're actually quite different in nature when you think about it. I mean, strategies is a joint, strategy. It's not something that can be piloted, for example. So yeah, they sound similar. I wonder why this person thinks it sounds similar. Do you have an idea, Jenny?
I think it's because it's about the development and then the uptake of it. So the theory behind it is very similar. that you develop mm-hmm. something and then it's about the uptake. But I agree with you, it's two different things. Pilot solution is more hands-on, really trying new solutions. Whereas then, as Annemieke has mentioned, strategies and action plans, it's more about the theoretical part of it. But what I would like to do, because time is ticking, I would like to refer you to the definitions of the individual indicators, output indicators, as well as results indicators in the fact sheet. And that will hopefully be published soon on our website. So after our PPG has met mid-November. I hope that answers the question. And I think this is the last question now. Is there an average project duration? Do you have an answer to this, Annemieke?
Yeah, and here again, it depends on the type of project you are applying for, because in the new program, we will also have small-scale projects, which if I'm right, a maximum lifetime of 18 months. I hope I'm saying that correctly. Can you confirm, Jenny, if that's indeed the case?
Yes.
Okay, it will at least be a lot shorter than regular projects, which I would say on average have a lifetime between 3 and 5 years.
Yeah, 3 and 5 years. I think this is what you say.
Yeah. So that's something you can think about when you design your project.
Yeah. And I think we will move on. As I said, time is ticking, but Annemieke will also say something in a short while about another webinar that we will have about small scale projects, because then you will learn more about all the details of a small scale project. But I would like to say now, thank you for all the questions you have put in. We have come close to the end of the webinar. We hope we have managed to make you familiar with the intervention logic and the different building blocks and the indicators of the future program. There will be a session during our NOSI conference this year in Bruges on the 25th of November. So I guess we will meet some of you there. If not, if you haven't signed up, don't worry. Because, Annemieke?
Because this webinar is, as we have said, recorded. So you will have plenty of opportunity to watch this webinar again and again and again when you're designing your intervention logic. So it's really available for when you're actually come to the point that you have to develop your intervention logic. And the small scale project webinar, as you already touched upon, Jenny, will take place this Wednesday, the 10th of November at 10 o'clock. So if you're interested in a small scale project, I would very much recommend to join that webinar. And with this message, we have actually come to the end of this webinar. I really hope we have achieved the objective we had for the session today, so you can make the right moves to make a winning project.
Yeah, and if you have a good idea for a project or would like to receive feedback from the secretariat, maybe also with focus on the intervention logic, please reach out to us. You can find our contact details on the website, also from the other project advisors. You are also welcome, as we've mentioned before, to contact our national contact points. You can also find their contact details on the website. And just for your information, when the first call opens, so beginning of December, all project advisors at the secretariat will have dedicated time slots that you can book, and then we can discuss your ideas or your questions with a little bit more time or a little bit more individually. And you can find more information about these time slots soon on our website, so you can book the time slot. Again, thank you very much for joining us today, and we hope to see you again soon.
Thank you.
And bye.